as well. My name is Nicholas Evans. I am a community ambassador for the Motthaven Community Partnership. Yes. What's your name and the program you work for?
Sure. So my name is Hager Shawkat, and I'm the program director of the Community Wellness Program at Sauti Yetu Center for African Women.
Okay. Sure. Okay.
Let
And
me
the second question is, how did this program come about?
Sure. So the Community Wellness Department actually started in 2016 to really support the rest of Sauti Yetu's work that started in 2004, that helped particularly African women dealing with gender-based violence and intimate partner violence. And there really wasn't at that time any resources available that spoke to people, that met people where they are based on their language need or their cultural background. And so Sauti Yetu came into being, and our first services really started around preventing and helping women dealing with intimate partner violence and gender-based violence, as I mentioned. And then we sort of expanded to helping families that may be in crisis in general. Our largest program is the Children and Family Services Program, which works, of course, with children who might be in danger of any sort in the household. And then we progressed to provide legal services as well as a professional development program through some of the international high schools in the Bronx, and it's called the Girls Empowerment and Leadership Initiative. And so each of these programs were very much in line with what Sauti Yetu hoped to do in supporting each of the family members that are there, that in our communities, in the African community, as well as other immigrant communities. And then Community Wellness came on board to really be there to support people, help them avoid the crisis that might lead them to reach out for the other services that Sauti Yetu provides. And so we're here really to engage with community members to help provide them both health education to help, you know, prevent many of the diseases and the illnesses that we know are prevalent in the community, as well as help link them to some of the healthcare resources. There thankfully are many that are available in the South Bronx, but sometimes there's so many that community members get inundated and are not sure where to turn to.
I appreciate that you do that kind of work. That's really awesome.
Thank you. Okay.
So the next question is, how long have you been in your position, and what were you doing before this job?
So I'm glad to say that Sauti Yetu is my longest job.
Nice.
But I've had some really, you know, great jobs and great experience. I've been working in public health for over 10 years now, and it's been in different sort of strengths and different capacities. So my first work was in research and really understanding what are the needs of the community and how to meet those needs. And then I moved on to do more evaluation work of programs and came to Sauti Yetu with sort of back in 2015, actually, came to the agency with a lot of background in how to do programs and measure if they've been effective or not, but not so much of the opportunity to really do a program that's tailored for a community that I identify with and grew up within. And now this was sort of the perfect marriage of where my professional training and education can be used to really benefit the folks that I'm most familiar with, just having grown up within those communities. And so I'm hoping to be here at Sauti Yetu for quite a while longer, but it's been about, yeah, a little about over 5 years now.
Awesome. I guess I don't have as much experience or anything, but I've been working at the Community Partnership for, I want to say almost a year now. Since last November. So yeah, that's for me. And before I was doing this, I was actually in my first year of college, and I wanted, you know, some kind of experience within the work field, as well as to kind of get to know my area. So it was kind of just an opportunity for me to basically do both, get to know a bunch of programs and other like resources around in my area. Because even before then, I didn't know much about my own area. I've been living here for past like 8 years or so. So it was a really good opportunity that I've decided to take.
Yeah, there's, like I said, there's so many resources that sometimes people get lost in sort of trying to navigate, like, which one should I go to? And sometimes it's just helpful to know, well, if, for example, Sauti Yetu is able to provide a resource in your language, then maybe that's why you turn to the agency and that's why you develop a relationship with the people that work here.
Definitely, definitely. Okay, so the next question is, what's your favorite thing about the work that you do?
So I really like this question because it was a little difficult to answer. I've honestly been blessed. I love the work that I do, mainly because I think it's that marriage between what I know innately, because having grown up in the community, and piecing that together with like the academic education that I have and the experience that I have working in, for example, in a hospital setting versus a foundation versus, you know, a social service agency that was very similar to Sauti Yetu, but with a much broader scope. And I think the best thing about all that work is that you're really never bored. There's always a piece of the puzzle, a piece of trying to improve community health that there's always work to be done on. And I think one of the best parts is being able to identify what are the assets that are already in the community and then how we can leverage them. I think that saves us a lot of time and we're not necessarily recreating the wheel. And there's also a lot of things that we found like community members are very proud of. There's a reason, you know, if you ever go to an event somewhere in the city and people are asking folks to represent their borough, people are like hooting and hollering for a reason because they're very proud of where they're from. And it's very similar for our immigrant communities as well. And we want to be able to say, well, you have that pride for a reason. There are many good pieces, get a components of your community or of where you live or your culture or your faith beliefs. How can we build on those to sort of strengthen and improve other areas of your life as well?
Definitely. I guess for me, the favorite thing about my work that I do is just the chance to kind of explore and meet new people and kind of build upon just learning new things in the area, as well as just learning new things about different people in different areas. It's just like it provides the opportunity to kind of step out of the little box that I have. So even just talking to you right now, or just learning about all these other different programs and what they may be able to provide for the community that I live in. And I think that's really awesome personally.
Yeah. So I know you mentioned you just started like your first year of college, but had you picked a major or like some area of concentration?
Yeah. So I'm a communications major. I'm currently in my second year right now, but it kind of that's kind of how it connects for me, the job that I work with in school, because it provides an opportunity for me to sort of work on my ability to communicate with other, you know, people, just be able to express myself and be able to understand what they're trying to express to me. So, yeah.
Yeah, no, that's great.
Okay, so the final question for introductions is, what's Sauti Yetu's mission and how has your process changed in response to COVID-19?
So the mission that I know I'm going to get right. The mission of Sauti Yetu is to really strengthen each member of the African immigrant community. And we start with women. Because we know that, you know, women really do make up the center of the community. But the overall mission is to strengthen their like connection to resources, improve their quality of life, and give them the voice. Like Sauti Yetu actually means our voices. And we want to be able to give an opportunity and share the stories of these community members that sometimes are overlooked. And we do that by providing and developing programs and resources that are based on what the community actually says they need, as well as marrying that very much with what we find is like what resources are available that, for example, the African immigrant community has not been able to access. And we love to ask why and try and connect them with those resources. And it's very key that we work with the entire family, children, parents, guardians, extended family members, because each one of those family units, our hope is to strengthen each person in the family unit, thereby strengthening the unit itself, and then the community as a whole, one family at a time. And so the process, I think, for COVID has not really changed. I think we're all working from home, but our resources have, our services have been even in more demand. And we've, particularly within the community wellness department, have needed to expand our purview to say, you know, we know that there are so many different things that influence people's health. And now that there's COVID-19 in the mix, what does that look like? What other services can we provide to help meet that need? So yes, we're doing more work since COVID-19. That's what's changed.
Basically, yeah, a lot more work. It's the same thing with us. It's kind of just the adjusting to the whole change, even though it's kind of, we've kind of been, you know, in the groove doing these kind of like interviews or questionnaires, you know, trying to get more people to just tune in if they need help with situations like this and stuff.
Yeah. But, yeah.
Okay, so now we can move on to the topic of the live session, which is health resources. So the first question is, what are reproductive rights?
Yes, so reproductive rights come out of our human rights. And so I think it would be helpful to start there, that our human rights are the basic needs and necessities that every human being should be able to access just because of the fact that they live in this world. So those human rights are something like, you know, the right to access health and the right to get an education, the right to, you know, freedom of speech, freedom of belief, all of these rights that some of which are in our Constitution and others we know of from the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights, but they're just the basic necessities of how to live. Now, within that, we know people are more familiar with, you know, yes, I have a right to shelter and food and gainful employment and an education. We have a bucket that are related to specifically our sexual and reproductive health. And so without them, we won't be able to fully, to live a fully, like a fulfilling life, because those rights that we have may be affected in some way. And so these reproductive rights or sexual rights are in relation to our relationships. So we have the right to be in relationships with people that we want to be in with, and we have a right to also choose not to be in a relationship with them. And when we're thinking about relationships, that can look like anything from family, friends, peer relationships, professional relationships, and the most popular are romantic relationships. But your reproductive rights work within the scope of those. Who are you in a relationship with? Did you choose those relationships? What do they look like? And then more importantly, the right to choose, you know, whether you want children, how many you want to have, when you want to have them, that all of those things we've found have been impacted by the people around us. Whether that means someone encouraging you to have more children when you're not comfortable with it, or your economic situation just doesn't allow for it. But all of those things are rights that everyone should be able to choose for themselves. And the reality is that we have the conversation about rights in a very ideal situation. Even the right to like health education, to be able to take care of your reproductive health, is very important and is considered one of those reproductive rights. And then we also have more conversations about, the reality is you can't exercise all of them. So how do you prioritize? How do you choose? And how do you live the best life for you?
Yeah, I completely agree with that. Literally everything you said, I completely agree with, because I know personally for myself, I would hate not being able to choose the type of relationships that I would want to have, or what, like having someone else basically decide what and what I cannot do within those relationships, that's like extremely overbearing. So knowing and carefully deciding what choices I make in those relationships genuinely do matter and are very important. So I definitely agree.